my last class, I discussed about the features of DC to AC converters. Okay. So one of the feature of DC to AC converter is that both output voltage and frequency should remain constant. There are another class of DC to AC converters wherein both output voltage and frequency should change till the output voltage is equal to the rated value, and from there onwards it should be able to keep this voltage constant and increase the frequency. Okay. So these are the basic two types of inverters are quite popular. There are basically two different possible construction in inverters. One is a voltage source inverter, wherein input is a stiff voltage source. The Thevenin equivalent impedance is approximately equal to 0. So input is strictly a voltage source, therefore the polarities of this voltage source cannot change. Okay. But then current should be able to reverse, or this inverter handles unidirectional voltage and bidirectional current. So the type of switches that are used in a VSI should be able to carry this bidirectional current. In other words, you need to connect a diode across the controllable switch. Okay. So another feature of a voltage source inverter is that the switching signals for the one leg of the inverter are complementary. See, this is the one leg of the inverter. These two are controllable switches, and these two are anti-parallel diodes. Okay. The positive direction of current or positive current can flow through this device, and negative current can flow through this device. I said gate signals for these two switches should be complementary. Okay. Since the Thevenin impedance is very small, it is very difficult to protect these devices against shoot through faults. Shoot through in the sense both devices are accidentally conducting. Okay. So if both devices are carrying current, a large current will flow. Okay. So in order to protect these two devices against shoot through faults, okay, a small dead time is provided between the gate signals of these two. Okay. In the sense, this device is turned off, and after some time this device is turned on. Another requirement on a voltage source inverter is that these two devices should be able to turn off very fast. In other words, these are fast devices, because if there is a shoot through fault, I have to withdraw the gate signal and thereby I should be able to protect them. Okay. So if they are slow, input is a stiff voltage source, has a practically zero impedance, series impedance. So a large current will flow and damage the devices. If the devices are fast, there is some hope in protecting this inverter. So therefore, one of the requirements of a voltage source inverter is that you need to have a fast devices. Okay. And second one is a current source inverter. A large inductor is connected in series with the input variable DC source. Why this is variable, we will see sometime later. And this is the inverter. Okay. There is a large inductor connected in series here. So current cannot change its direction. But then input voltage to the inverter can change its polarities. Okay. So therefore, it is not possible to use the devices having anti-parallel diodes. Okay. Because if there is an anti-parallel diode, those voltages, those devices cannot block voltage in the reverse fashion. Remember, if there is a device with an anti-parallel diode, that device cannot block the voltage in the reverse direction. Okay. So in a CSI inverter, the devices having anti-parallel diodes cannot be used. Okay. Cannot. It's not possible to use. So another feature of CSI is that a large inductor is connected in series. So circuit is very rugged and reliable. Why it is rugged and reliable? Assume that there is a shoot through fault here. Shoot through in the sense one leg accidentally turning on. Since there is a large inductor, current cannot change very fast. Okay. And now it is possible to protect this inverter against shoot through faults by withdrawing the gate signals, which is a bit rather difficult in a voltage source inverter because input impedance is practically zero. Here there is a large inductor, current cannot change instantaneously, current has to change slowly. So the moment the moment the shoot through is detected, you withdraw the gate signals, so devices are turned off. So it is possible to protect a current source inverter against shoot through faults, which is not the case in a voltage source inverter. Okay. We also discussed in the last class about a off bridge voltage source inverter. Okay. The input voltage, the magnitude of the input voltage is VDC. We had a VDC by 2, VDC by 2 center point we took as a reference point. But then output voltage, the magnitude is VDC by 2. See in this figure. Okay. Input is VDC, output is a square with half VDC. Output voltage waveform is a square wave with half VDC. So it has all the odd harmonics, 3rd, 5th, 7th, 9th, 11th, so on. And the total harmonic distortion is of the order of 48%. See, this figure we had calculated in AC to DC conversion. We had a source current is approximately a square wave. We assume that load current is constant and ripple free, therefore source current became a square wave, and we derived the total harmonic distortion and we found that this value is of the order of 48%. Okay. So remember, the output voltage in a Our bridge inverter, voltage source inverter has 48% harmonic content. Okay. We also found that output, the frequency of the output voltage can be varied by varying the on time of each device. Okay. So as of now, we found a way to vary the frequency of the output voltage. You keep the device on for say 10 millisecond, one device. So total period becomes 20 milliseconds. So I have a 50 hertz supply. Okay. So we know how to vary the frequency of the output voltage waveform. So far we have not discussed as to how to vary the magnitude of the output voltage. Okay. As of now, whatever is the input voltage, in this case, though I have a VDC by 2 and a VDC by 2, in fact the total is VDC, I have a VDC by 2 and a minus VDC by 2. Okay. In the last class, we also found that just because a device is kept on for 10 milliseconds or T by 2 seconds, it does not mean that the device, the controllable device, is carrying the current. No. It may so happen that the diode which is connected across the device may be conducting. Okay. So we found that if this controllable device is a SCR, gate pulses should be present till the current through it is higher than the latching. Okay. So you need to have a broad pulses if the device, controllable device, are SCRs. Okay. Now we will discuss the inverter feeding, off-bridge inverter feeding a purely inductive load. Please try to listen to me, because it is a very important feature of a voltage source inverter. Okay. This feature is extensively used in power factor correction. Okay. Maybe after discussing this, I will go back to AC to DC converter. Okay. We had already discussed that that power circuit configuration. Okay. So try to understand this principle. Okay. Same circuit configuration, I have connected an ideal inductor here. We have VDC by 2, VDC by 2. Okay, two switches. S1 is on for T by 2 period and it is off for another T by 2 period. S1 and S2 are complementary. So voltage across the inductor is VDC by 2 and minus VDC by 2. Okay. So therefore, from 0 to T by 2, voltage applied to the inductor is constant and is equal to VDC by 2. Therefore, current in the inductor increases linearly. Okay. LdI by dt is equal to V. Since V is constant, I increases linearly. Okay. So at steady state, you will find that this period, a period for which D1 conducts, is T by 4 cycles. Okay. See, in the positive of current increases linearly, and in the negative of current should decrease linearly. Okay. Now, average input power should be 0, because I have an ideal inductor, and I have considered, I assume that devices are also ideal. Remember, devices are ideal, inductor is ideal. So power transferred from the source to the inductor, average power should be 0. Okay, average power transferred to the inductor should be 0. Okay. Average, this is the input voltage, this is the current. Okay. So upper half area, this area should be equal to this area. Okay. So if this is T by 2, this should be T by 4, 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 okay, at steady state, it should be symmetrical, okay. So what you can infer? Average power supplied to this load is 0, okay. If the devices are ideal, input power to this inverter feeding a purely inductive load is 0. I will repeat, I have assumed ideal inductor, inverter devices are ideal. Ideal inductor, average power input is 0. Ideal devices, there are no switching losses or inverter efficiency is 100%. Therefore, input power to the inverter is 0, average input power is 0. So, if the input average power is 0, I can remove the input batteries. Remember, I can remove the input batteries and I can connect two capacitors. Why two capacitors? Because each two capacitors, each of VDC by 2 and VDC by 2. Because at steady state, average power transferred by this capacitor is going to be 0. Okay? So, I need to charge this capacitor only once and I will connect it to the connected to this inverter. So for some time, so during this period, see voltage is positive, current is negative, therefore power transferred to the load is negative. In other words, load is supplying power back to the source. See here, voltage positive, current negative, power input to the load is negative. So what does it mean? Load is supplying power back to the source. So, in this region, source is charging, and in this region, see voltage positive, current positive. So, power input is positive. So, source is discharging. Again, source is charging and source is discharging in this period. So, you can replace these two batteries by capacitors. You charge the capacitor once and forget about it. Okay? Of course, this is an ideal case. Okay? If I take the non-idealities into account, what are the non-idealities? Inductor having a small resistance and the device losses, which are again very small. The source has to supply a very small amount of active power, a very small amount of active power. That power is dissipated as heat in the resistor, in the inductor, and some is dissipated as heat as switching losses, inverter losses. Okay. So, if the inverter is loaded, fully loaded by an inductive load, okay, the active power input to this inverter is very small, very small. This active power is used to overcome the losses in the inverter and the I square losses that are taking place in an inductor. So, remember, if the inverter is fully loaded by a purely inductive load, the input active power is very small, very small. Okay? See, this is almost same as a generator supplying a purely inductive load. Okay? A generator supplying a purely inductive load. What is the active power transfer to the load? Is approximately 0. Okay? So, if I neglect the generator losses, the I square R winding losses or something. What do I need to do? I have to just rotate the rotor in the magnetic field, that is all. And this input is approximately 0. I have to just rotate the conductor, or I have to just rotate the rotor in that magnetic field. Input is practically 0, or turbine input is 0. Because active power transferred to the load is 0. So, input is output plus losses. If I neglect the losses, input is also 0. But then there has to be, or there is current flowing in the load. So, there has to be a voltage induced. I have to rotate, or the rotor has to be rotated in that magnetic field. That is all. Active power input is practically 0. Okay, almost the same. So, what is the third case? Third case is a RLC load, inverter feeding a RLC load. Okay, or the frequency of operation or the frequency of supply applied to this load is less than the resonant frequency. Okay. Remember, in a series RLC, the frequency of the voltage applied to the RLC circuit is less than the resonant frequency. Okay. Power factor of the circuit is leading. Power factor of the circuit is leading because magnitude of XC is higher than magnitude of XL. Okay. So, in a series RLC circuit, with XC higher than XL, current flowing through the load could be a damped sine wave. Current flowing through the load could be a damped sine wave as shown in this figure. Okay. So, at steady state, you may have a current flowing in this fashion. Okay. Now, just see what happens here. Devices or S1 is turned on for T by 2 radians. Okay. Current is leading. So, current has become 0, see here, current has become 0 at this point, and after that S1 is turned off. See, S1 is turned off at this point, or gate signal to S1 is withdrawn at this point and S2 is turned on. Since the power factor is leading, current has already become 0 much before the voltage has reversed its polarities. Okay. So, positive voltage, positive current, okay, positive voltage, positive current. So, S1, the controllable switch, is carrying the current. Okay. See, positive voltage, negative current in this region, positive voltage, negative current. Okay. It can happen only when D1 is carrying the current. Okay. It can happen only when D1 is carrying current. This is D1. Okay. Positive voltage, negative current. Similarly, here negative voltage, negative current from this point to this point. Okay. Current is being carried or flowing through, or current is flowing through this controllable switch S2. Negative voltage, positive current. Okay. Negative voltage, positive current. Current is flowing through D2. Okay, this should be D2. This should be D2. This should be D1. Okay. So, see the difference here. S1 conducts first, afterwards the diode connected across it starts conducting. Okay. Then S2 starts conducting. The diode connected across it starts conducting. Just the opposite. If the load is inductive, see here, D1 starts conducting first, then switch 1, S1. D2 started conducting first, S2 starts conducting later. So, what is the advantage of this sort of a system? A inverter feeding a leading load, or inverter feeding a load with leading power factor. See, I observed much before the device is turned off, I remember much before the voltage has reversed the polarities, current through the controllable switch has become 0. And it has started flowing through its anti-parallel diode. Remember, the device has turned off of its own. Gate signal may be present, but then current is not flowing through it. It was flowing, it became 0, and it has started flowing through anti-parallel diode. In other words, device has turned off of its own. Why? That is because of load power factor is leading. So this sort of a turn off process is known as load commutation. I will repeat, load commutation. Why? Load current has become 0 much before voltage has changed its polarities. In other words, the controllable switch has a current through the controllable switch has become 0 much before the gate signal has withdrawn. So this is known as the load commutation. So therefore, if the inverter devices are SCRs, what will happen in this case? Or before discussing this, if the inverter devices are SCRs and if it is feeding a inductive load, what will happen? See, we all know SCR can be turned on using gate, but then SCR cannot be turned off using a gate signal. If I withdraw the gate signal after the current is higher than the latching, SCR will not turn off. I can turn off the SCR only by reducing the current flowing through it to a value which is less than the holding current. In other words, current through the device should be less than the holding. How did we do in AC to DC converter? See here, I will just recall. See, fully controlled bridge. In the positive off, at alpha we triggered T1 and T2. In the negative off, T3, T4 were triggered. So in the negative off, potential of B is higher than potential of A. So when T3 is triggered, the input voltage appears across T1 in the reverse fashion. See, B gets connected here. So a negative input voltage appears across the thyristor and thyristor turns off. What did we call this process, turn off process? We called it as line commutation. Why did we call line commutation? Line voltage is used to turn off the thyristor. The previous case, load power factor is leading, current has become 0, so SCR has turned off of its own. SCR has turned off its own. That sort of a turn off process is known as load commutation. Now, what if the load is lagging, or RL load? See here the waveform, voltage waveform, current. So at this point, it is desired to turn off the upper thyristor and turn on the lower thyristor. At this instant, you find that current is, of course, this magnitude of current is determined by the load, a positive current is flowing through the load. In other words, this current is being carried or is flowing through the thyristor. Okay. Then how do I turn off the thyristor? Unless until I turn off the upper thyristor, I cannot turn on the lower thyristor. But current is a large current is flowing through the SCR. It cannot turn off of its own. What should I do? See here, I have to turn off the conducting thyristor and I have to turn on the lower thyristor. It does not matter the current, by even if I turn on the lower thyristor, current may not flow through it, but then diode starts, the diode connected across it starts carrying the current. Fine, fair enough. But then I have to turn off the conducting thyristor at this point. Current is finite. How do I do? You can do, or thyristor can be turned off by applying a reverse voltage across it. Somehow we have to apply a reverse voltage across the thyristor. Somehow a reverse voltage has to be applied across the thyristor, or external. This generally is done using a separate L and C circuit. I repeat, somehow a separate voltage has to be applied across the conducting thyristor in the reverse direction, or you have to reverse bias the thyristor for some time by applying a reverse voltage. How to do? Generally, it is done using separate L and C circuit. Okay. So this sort of a turn off process is known as forced commutation. Why forced commutation? We are forcibly turning off the thyristor by applying a separate voltage across it. Hence the name forced commutation. Okay. So we have studied line commutation, load commutation, and forced commutation. Okay. In a forced commutated inverter, okay, apart from the device in the sense controllable device switch as well as freewheeling diode, okay, there are additional L and C elements are required. Okay. This additional L and C elements are used to turn off the thyristor forcibly. Therefore, the size of the inverter, roll inverter, becomes really big. The inverter is bulky, okay, and it is noisy also, because the L and C elements. Therefore, the present day inverters, they do not use thyristors. Okay. So most of the inverters, they use self-commutating devices. Self-commutating devices. And in case thyristors are used in the inverter, they should be fast enough. In other words, inverter grade thyristors are required. Because reason is simple, the same thing, because input impedance is practically zero. For a shoot through fault, you have to, in order to protect the inverter against shoot through faults, device should be fast enough. Okay. So there are two types of SCRs, one is a converter grade SCR and another one is an inverter grade SCR. So in a VSI, in case thyristors are to be used, so one has to going for inverter grade SCRs. Okay. Invariably, these inverters are on their way out. There are almost all the inverters are with self-commutating devices. Okay. Having said that, so there is an exception. I told you, if the load power factor is leading, okay, you don't require separate LNC. The thyristor turns of its own. Okay. So while covering the devices, I told you that thyristors are a bit rugged, more rugged compared to other controllable devices. Thyristor is more rugged compared to IGBT, BJT, the devices. Okay. Or the cost of thyristor of the same voltage and current rating is much less compared to the other self-commutating devices. The problem with SCR is I can't turn it off using gate. But here is a load wherein the power factor is leading, so I don't require additional LNC to turn it off. If that is the case, using thyristors is a really an attractive proposition. So, I will repeat, if the load power factor is leading, you don't require additional LNC. I require just the thyristors and along with the anti-parallel diodes maybe. Okay. This inverter is really attractive compared to other inverters or its counterpart. Okay. But then you require a load with the leading power factor. So which load has a leading power factor? Recall your machines theory, whatever that you studied in a machines course. We have been told that synchronous machine or synchronous motor, if you overexcite it, power factor becomes leading. So therefore, the overexcited synchronous motor, which is being fed from a thyristor inverter, is very attractive. Very attractive. It is still maybe being used. Okay. This combination is called as or known as load commutated inverter fed synchronous motor. I will repeat, load commutated inverter fed synchronous motor. Okay. The inverter configuration is really simple, only six switches, very rugged and cost is less. I said load is a synchronous motor. Our teacher who taught machines has told that synchronous machines are invariably used in high power applications. High power applications. Okay. So as the power rating increases, okay, the cost of semiconductor devices, the cost of self-commutating devices also increases. So if I can use SCR, nothing like it, nothing like it. So that is the reason load commutated inverter fed synchronous motor is still being used. And load commutated inverter using SCRs is very attractive. I don't think the inverter with other devices can compete with load commutated inverter using SCRs. Okay. Now let's continue. What are the limitations of off-bridge inverter? Now forget about the load. Input, I had VDC, but then output, I have a square wave of half VDC. Only one device is conducting at a time. So if there is a half bridge, there has to be a full bridge. So here is the configuration. Okay. So four devices along with the freewheeling diodes, and the load is connected between these two devices, see here, and the input VDC. Say, I do not require or the center point of the DC bus is not required. Center point of is not required, the center point is not required. Okay. How does it work? Two devices are conducting at a time, see in this, S1 and S2 are turned on, what happens? VDC, S1, load, S2, back here, VDC, S1, load, S2, back here, voltage applied to the load is VDC. After some time or T by 2 seconds, open S1 and S2, close S3, S4. Now, VDC, S3, load, S4, back. So, minus VDC is being applied to the load. Okay. So, S1, S2, S3, S4. Okay, T by 2, T, a pi by pi radians, and this is 2 pi, okay, pi and 2 pi radians, okay. Voltage is positive, current is negative, because I have assumed RL load, at steady state, you have a current waveform something like this. Okay. Positive voltage, negative current. So, in this circuit, if you see, positive voltage can happen only when this point is connected here and this point is connected here. Negative current, current is flowing back to the source. So, it can happen only when D2 and D1 are conducting. Okay. It can happen only when D2, D1 are conducting. So, see here. So, in this region, positive voltage, negative current, D1 and D2 are conducting. Positive voltage, positive current, S1, S2, and so on. Okay. So, principle of operation of half bridge and full bridge is almost the same, except in full bridge, two devices are conducting at a time. Voltage applied is VDC, input is also VDC, output also VDC. Okay. So, this is about the single phase inverter. Okay. I have not discussed so far how to vary the output voltage. We will see sometime later. Okay. Now, we will see or discuss the operation of three phase inverter. Okay. I said three phase inverter. So, you require three phase voltages A, B, C, three phase voltages. Okay. They should have a phase displacement of 120 degrees. Okay. So, what I have done here, I use three half bridges. That is the reason I called you half bridge as a basic block. Okay. In a H bridge or full bridge, there are two legs, here there are three legs. Okay. As of now, listen to me, as of now, I have used the center point of the DC link. Okay, this. I have taken this as the reference. After some time, we will find that this is not required. You can take the negative bus as the reference. Okay, I will repeat, you can take negative bus as the reference. For convenience, I have taken this as the reference point. Okay. operation is the same for T by 2 period S1 is closed and for the remaining T by 2 S4 is closed. So, when will you close S3? S3 is closed after 120 degrees closing S1 because phase displacement between them should be 120 and again 120 here. Okay. When S1 is on, voltage or potential of A with respect to O is VDC by 2. Okay. When S1 is on, VA0, when S1 is on, VA0 is VDC by 2. And when S1 is off, I am just saying S1 is off, that does not, it implies that S4 is on, VA0 is minus VDC by 2. Similarly, have VBO and you can have VCO. But then now I am more interested in line to line voltages. What is VAB or what is VBC? VAB is nothing but VA0 minus VB0. VAB is VA0 minus VB0. Okay. Remember this equation. I will show you the waveforms here. See here. VA0 for pi radians is VDC by 2. For the remaining pi radians, it is another VDC by 2. S1 on, S4 on. After 2 pi by 3 radians, S3 is turned on. Okay. S3 is turned on. See, this is 120 degrees, so S3 is turned on here. So, if S3 is becomes on here, S6 should become off. Okay. Because S3 and S6 are complementary. So, if this is the on period of S3, it implies that this should be off period for S3. So, in this period, S6 is on. Okay. So, similarly, VC0 is S5 is on 0 to pi by 3 radians, okay, and S2 is on here in this zone. Now, what is VAB? VAB is VA0 minus VB0. So, from 0 to 2 pi by 3, VA0 is VDC by 2, VB0 is minus VDC by 2. Okay. So, therefore, VAB is VDC. Remember, VA0 minus VB0, but VB0 itself is negative. So, VA0 is VDC. From 2 pi by 3 to pi radians, both VA0 and VB0 are positive. So, and they are equal. So, VA0 minus VB0 is 0. Okay. So, from 2 pi by 3 to pi, it is 0. Okay. And of course, this is the negative half with VDC. Okay. What happens to VCA? VCA is nothing but VA0 minus VC0. From 0 to pi by 3, VA0 and VC0 are positive, magnitude is the same. So VCA is negative. Okay. And from pi by 3 to pi, VCA is VDC, minus VDC. Okay. So I have drawn line voltages of VAB and VCA. Okay. Similarly, you can draw VBC also, same philosophy. Okay. In my next class, we will consider various loads, 3-phase inverter feeding a delta connected load and a star connected load. We will draw the current waveforms and we will see what are the limitations of this inverter, in the sense wherein each device is conducting for 180 degrees or pi radians. Okay. So I will stop here. Thank you.